Hi, and welcome to Studio 411. I'm your host, Larry Dasilva. Well, we've got one of our favorite guests joining us again here for another exciting program. Author Mark Allen Baker, who's been on the show with several books that he's written. Mark's written 20-plus books at this point in his career. He's got a book that we're going to be talking about on a gentleman that was a boxing champion, a lightweight champion back in the turn of the 20th century, Oscar Nelson, better known in the boxing world back in the day, and certainly in International Boxing Hall of Fame circles, as Battling Nelson. And before we get to Mark, we've got a little clip to kind of give you a little taste of what our subject was about and what we're going to be talking about with Mark. So why don't we roll that clip, and we'll be back after that. All right, we're back, and what a phenomenal clip that was. I enjoyed it because, again, the imagery was, you would think it was literally taken yesterday in black and white, of course, but just phenomenal HD quality. But anyway, enough said with that. We welcome back to Studio 411 Mark Allen Baker. Mark, haven't I seen you here before?
I think so, maybe a couple times. It's a pleasure to be back here.
Oh, my goodness. Nice, and the full title of the book, by the way, Battling Nelson, the Durable Dane, two-time world lightweight champion. Again, born 1882 to lived until 1954. And that's from McFarlane Publishers. For more information, www.mcfarlanepub.com. All right. I know you are certainly have always been for the last many years very much involved. As a matter of fact, we did a boxing show a while back with the International Boxing Hall of Fame. For those viewers who may not know, as I didn't, believe it or not, where the Boxing Hall of Fame is located.
It's in a little village in upstate New York called Canastota, New York.
Okay.
Not too far from Syracuse.
And you have been involved there. As a matter of fact, you have the distinction of being the only person to serve the International Boxing Hall of Fame as an author, historian, chairperson, sponsor, volunteer, and biographer. So if anybody knows every inch of that place, it would be Mark. So where did the idea or the inspiration come? How did you come to say, I got to write a book about this guy?
It's interesting, Larry, because when Oscar, I'll call him Oscar, when Battling Nelson was inducted into the Hall of Fame, I was in my sponsor role back then, but I was also writing the biographies for the Hall. And as I was going through and I'm writing the various biographies of the fighters that are being inducted, I did long biographies, short biographies, and I'm running across Oscar's, and I'm using his autobiography, which came out in 1908. And that's kind of the last time anybody heard of Oscar battling Matthew Nelson. So I'm thinking, well, geez, everything must have turned out great because Oscar said so, but it ends in 1908 and he lives to 1954. So I started digging and digging and digging, and I find this phenomenal story starting to emerge, a lot different than I expected, with a lot of twists and turns. And I said, I've got to put this down. I've got to write this story, because the only book about Oscar is the one that he wrote himself. And I said, even that is somewhat, let's just say, stretches the truth a little bit here and there.
Somewhat dubious, perhaps.
maybe stretches things a little bit. So I decided, I'm going to go back to ground zero. I'll take Oscar back down to ground zero and rebuild him. Talk a little bit more about his rise to fame. And then what happened afterwards? All of a sudden he falls off the end of the earth, and it's like, where'd he go? What happened?
There you go. So this is probably, I don't know, but it reminds me of what they used to call back in those days, even for ball players, was cigar cards. You know, in a box of cigars, yeah, you'd get something. And you know how in later years when we were kids, you'd have like the players look like they were leaping in the air. Well, in this case, everybody was always hunched over, like looked like they were delivering the killer punch. Couple of things here, and again, there's so much information that I'm trying to get to on this. When or why or all of the above, again, barehanded, when did they come out with the boxing gloves?
Well, I mean, the transition was gradual. I mean, in the old days, we know the whole story behind John L. Sullivan and the, being the bare knuckle champion, and then the evolution to being the first glove champion. Obviously, there was a lot of damage being done. So, and gloves have matured. So back then, I'm sure this is posed without the gloves, but back then he was using a lot of skin-tight gloves. Here we've got bigger gloves.
There, sure.
Those were probably 7-ounce gloves, a little bit bigger for training. But, I mean, he was using 4, 5, 6, 7-ounce gloves, depending on the circumstance. They got bigger because what was happening was there was a lot of damage being done,
sure,
to the fighters. So by the time New York started instituting their own laws, with their athletic commission around 1920, when they finally legalized boxing, and it was 7-ounce gloves.
Talk about within the boxing world, and even in your research, what you kind of perhaps already knew, but maybe were even heightened more about. Talk about racism that was prevalent. I mean, obviously we know.
It was awful. I mean, the one thing that I like about boxing is how it parallels our society. That's the interesting. And it parallels in so many ways, because if you look at the way they design fight posters, for example, I mean, even how that transition also changed photography, changed the fine arts, the way they look at poster design, and it was a migration, and the parallels of boxing and society are fascinating. So what I enjoyed the most with this was delving into sensitive areas, like racism and how it was handled. Of course, you know, white fighters, a lot of white fighters didn't fight black fighters. Black fighters, a lot of black fighters only fought other black fighters. And of course, everybody knows the story behind Jack Dempsey, whose management would not allow him to fight a black fighter, even though Dempsey himself would. But Oscar's story is fascinating because, you know, he's an immigrant, he comes here, and racism is almost accepted. And what I, you know, years before Johnson fought Jeffries, here's Joe Gans battling Nelson, a black fighter versus a white fighter. And it said originally two-time champion, which was changed to world lightweight champion on the book, two-time, because he won the white lightweight championship.
I was going to say, yeah, they had him as one, and then they had him as the white lightweight. And I'm like, what's this?
Yeah.
And then I figured, well, they've got it. You know, like before Don King came along, we've got it split into two divisions.
Yeah, well, we had it on the book as two-time, and then I called him. I said, you might want to change it because it could be viewed as racist,
right,
almost, as condoning a separation of champion, which was not at all the case. Oscar wouldn't have wanted that way, and certainly boxing wouldn't have wanted that way. Nobody was lightweight champion back and hit battling Nelson's age until they beat Joe Gans.
Sure.
I mean, Joe Gans was the man. He was like most people are familiar with Ali and Tyson. Joe Gans owned the lightweight division. And until you beat Joe Gans, you weren't a champion.
Yeah. There's a quote in the book. You talk about rags to riches to rags. And the thought when I read that was, well, isn't that still very prevalent today, even with the greater boxing purses, you know?
It's amazing. You would think that as much as we've seen that scenario play out in boxing, the rags to riches to rags, that there would be a learning process involved. but perhaps boxing is a little bit slower than we thought, because it's playing out, it seems, generation after generation after generation.
The old adage, the more you have, the more you spend.
Yeah, exactly. And in his case, I mean, when you read his autobiography, trust me, when you read his autobiography, you would think that he's, you know, lives in a mansion in the best part of Chicago, and he's basically runs the town and has all the wealth you'd ever dream of. And that's not what happened. Yeah. I mean, he ended up stretching himself.
In this photo, and I'm going to assume that perhaps this was an authentic signature, but again, he or the people that would sign this would identify him as Bat. So that was kind of a nickname, Battling the Bat Nelson. So that
a lot
becomes,
of times, yeah, for a long time, they thought Battling was just a moniker.
Yeah.
But he was actually his name.
Sure.
His name was given from his mother's side, and so his name was Oscar Battling Matthew Nielsen, and of course the Nielsen name got, he changed it to Nelson. Some of the other family members kept Nielsen, but Nielsen coming from Denmark, I mean, Nielsen is like Smith and Jones.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah.
Coming from Denmark is a very popular name, surname.
Born in Denmark, or Copenhagen, Denmark, in 1882, a family settled in the U.S. Via boat in 1883. And just to give you a little background information, as Mark does throughout the book, 1883, the memorable Chester A. Arthur was president. The first vaudeville theater opened in Boston, Mass. I would love to know which one it is, because it's probably now been converted to a concert venue, like the one I go to in Beverly, Mass., which I can't think of the name right now. Mark Twain coined the phrase the Gilded Age, and that was referring to that period of time. Again, you know, you as you tell the story, you kind of educate folks a little bit with tidbits about what was going on in the U.S. at that time.
Yeah, I mean, this was an enjoyable process. This was my first biography, and I really wanted to bring my audience into it. I wanted to get them their mindset proper, so I didn't have to. You'll see a lot of tricks in the book too. I use a lot of tricks in the biography as we start moving along, where I'll mention certain names that you can almost bet are going to surface two chapters down the road, or I'm going to have a link as to why did I mention them here. There must be a reason, and there is in a lot of cases.
I also forgot to mention in that time period, boxer John L. Sullivan was becoming America's first sports superstar. And also, think about it, 130 plus years later, or early, became the first athlete to earn over $1 million, which in money in 1880, 1890, 1900 is a staggering amount of money.
Incredible when you think of it. And everybody took, all the boxers, I mean, John L. Sullivan really wrote the book on how to be a champion. So a lot of boxers, including Battling Nelson, we're kind of modeling themselves in the same manner. So Bat or Oscar, I call him Oscar, maybe it's out of respect, but I like the name, so I call him Oscar. He was taking pages out of the John L. Sullivan champion book, so to speak. So he would spout off, you know, I can beat so-and-so, and, you know, bring him on, give me, you know, $20,000. And he would spout off like Sullivan used to spout off endlessly.
But in those early days, it might have been $20.
I mean, you know,
I saw some of the grosses for, like, the first very early years, you know, before, kind of reminds me of doing this show. You know, I mean, lucky if you made about $20 for the year.
Yeah. Right.
Oh, and here's one again, a photo or postcard, whatever, that's signed Sincerely Battling Nelson. Again, handsome.
Good looking man.
But you notice, and you'll see later as the years went on, the nose got considerably wider. You know, too many shots to the nose.
And as you read, you'll see that he became very self-conscious about his looks. And he actually went to a plastic surgeon.
His 1920s, which I found that fascinating.
I mean, can you imagine that? But a lot of boxers at that time, I call it a bout with resurfacing. But he really, a lot of boxers, I mean, he literally, when you watch the film, and if you ever get a chance, there's plenty of footage on YouTube, but he goes in with his head first. I mean, literally leads with his head, and instead of leading with his right or his left, he's leading in with his head and taking a tremendous amount of damage.
On a more heavier weight, or true heavyweight, but it reminds me a little of the Joe Frazier style of fighting, or was there someone on a lighter class that you would compare his style to?
Actually, the one guy who compared the best with him is also a Hall of Famer. He fought and took the crown from him was Ad Wolgast.
Okay.
There was a lot of parallels. And in fact, one of the chapters in the book, the two of them are so closely identified that it's almost, I mean, I bring up the old story of Thomas Jefferson and John Adams, because they were always, there was always that confrontation, and, you know, right to the very end on their deathbed. It was the same with Wolgast and Nelson.
There's Mark always throwing in a revolutionary period piece. That's
got to work in those Connecticut books, right?
From one of his other books, yeah. Now, the family, after they came from Copenhagen, Denmark, settled in Oshkosh, Wisconsin, and later relocated to the Chicago, Illinois area, which, of course, I'm sure, like so many large cities like New York, Boston, but probably Chicago even more so, a hotbed for boxing.
You know? Yeah, oh, very much, yeah. Very much. And he settled in a little town, a little suburb, which was called Hegwisch, and which is now, which totally got absorbed by Chicago as Chicago started spreading mm-hmm. out. Now it doesn't even look like it would ever be a suburb. And he basically owned the whole town at one point.
Yeah. I have to ask, is this Mr. Attell?
That looks like Abraham.
It is.
That's Abraham.
Yeah, okay.
Those two guys I knew very well.
We'll talk a little bit more about that later, but yeah.
And they fought each other. And, of course, Bat was one division up. Bat was a lightweight.
My one comment there is they need to wear darker shorts, because when I first looked at that, I thought I was watching like a a nudist fight.
Oh, I know. I mean, it was so different back then. I mean, this, I would have loved to have been to a Briton. He fought Jimmy Britt, who was one of the best fighters in the San Francisco Bay Area, four times. And Britt was the guy he took the white championship from.
Yeah. $5 main floor. Do you think you could get a seat for $5 today?
Yeah.
You couldn't get, back in the day when we used to all go somewhere to watch closed circuit, you couldn't get
$5. No, I mean, if you think back to the days we were watching Ali Frazier on closed circuit.
Oh, yeah. Or,
I don't even know what we paid.
No, I would be like 20, waiting 25. For it on ABC's Wide World of Sports.
And that would be the condensed version.
Yes. Oh,
you
yeah,
never got the
yeah,
whole fight.
No.
And that brings up another thing, too, is this was the era where fight films first started going. Taking off, and all of a sudden boxers learned that we can make a few bucks by going out and selling the film, you know, premiering the film and charging for that and making an appearance afterwards.
Now, you mentioned the fighter that he fought, pronounce his name, Wolgast? Again, here's a shot. Nearing the end of the contest, Nelson became very weak on his legs, and when he would close in, Wolgast would always throw his weight on him. Weakness is shown by the manager in which, or the manner in which his knees are caving in.
And they were both like that. They both leveraged themselves and led in like that.
You're lucky
and
there wasn't a lot of cuts in the headbutts.
I mean, you should see some of the pictures, especially his fight with Mr. Attell. I mean, it was, some of them got really bloody.
And now, just for all of us, the weight class was like in the around the 130s.
Yeah, we're looking at lightweights at about 132, 133. Later, around 1912, they brought up to about 135, and Attell at that time was fighting about 122, one division down.
Now here's a shot. You're the aforementioned Mr. Britt there. Now, quite a good crowd, and
that was in San Francisco.
Yeah, I mean, again, I don't see too many females in the crowd here.
No,
I
think very it was seldom. It wasn't until Tex Rickard started getting Rickard got him there. Eventually, he started putting special sections in for him. They were a novelty. If you saw a female, I mean, the whole place would all of a sudden come to a standstill.
Sure.
Because in walks a beautiful woman, and you're like, wait, there's a fight.
I can remember as a kid, and we may have talked about this on an earlier show, was, you know, you watch some older clips, and if the footage is pretty good, you know, we're talking 60s, 70s, 80s, mm-hmm. and now, but back in those decades, you know, you could almost pick out, you know, celebrities in the audience.
Definitely.
I mean, you'd see, you know, oh, looky, so-and-so, look at, and men and women. I mean, they were really into
it. Oh, absolutely. Think of the Ali Frazier fight.
Sinatra doing the photography.
Absolutely, the
And of course, not to mention all the dignitaries, boxers, et cetera. So, and that played here as well.
And there
well.
Were a lot of them that showed up to this, too. I mean, I mentioned some of the dignitaries in the book, but they would be from only ones that people who knew their California history would know who they were. And they would run special, you know, cars to go to the fight. And the promoter, in this case, built a special arena just for certain fights.
Now, tell me, if I read correctly, how did the circus coming to town play a pivotal part in...
This is another one. I mean, I was talking to a friend of mine that's doing is a screenwriter, and he's doing a boxing film about... I've been working on a Willie Pep film for people who follow Connecticut boxing. But anyway, I was telling him, and he was, we were kind of laughing, is that if I wrote a story where a boxer, his first fight is he beats a strong man at a circus, you would say, you're crazy. I mean, you're crazy. That's the most ridiculous thing ever. But that's exactly what happened. The circus came to town, the Wallace shows came to town, and when you were a kid, everybody looked forward to going to the circus. And there was an offer. If you can beat the strong man over here, we'll give you a couple bucks. And sure enough, that's how it happened.
There's a quote here, apparently Oscar Nelson called it, the boxing bee in my bonnet. Now, was that where that term in effect came from, or was he just kind of using it?
It came from then. Though there's an interesting, the whole slogan, you know the term bringing home the bacon?
Sure.
That came from Joe Gans.
Oh, really?
That's where that original saying came from.
Now, Joe Gans, who we'll see a little bit more later, again, it did not live very long. Again, tuberculosis?
In many ways, and this is something that kind of, I mean, the first Gans fight where the first time he fought Joe Gans, he lost on a foul late in the fight, which he never...
40 rounds, or a 40-plus round.
Talk about frustration,
right? Exactly.
I mean, wow. I probably would have, done a lower shot, sooner, so to speak. But he never did really fess up to it, but it was everybody. I was meticulous about the research.
Now, was that one of the filmed footage that they started filming?
That was filmed. There is Joe Gans footage of the Gans fights.
The low blow?
I'm pretty sure
there
is.
Oh, yeah,
wow,
amazing.
So, but, I mean, it was definitely low. It's unfortunate, but it was low.
Here's a poster that I came across in Colma, California, which for some reason, Colma, along with a city or two in Nevada, seem to be hotbeds on the West Coast for some of these fights.
And it became known as a place filled with graveyards because they couldn't bury the people in San Francisco, so they ended up burying them out in Colma.
Oh, wow.
So, but this is where a guy by the name of Kofroth was the promoter back then, and this was his place where he put on, this was his arena, this was his baby, and he really made it famous thanks to people like Nelson and Burr.
Summer of 1890, battling Nelson left home, seek fortune, landing in South Dakota of all places, worked a series of jobs until finding his early success as a boxer. 1899, moved back to Chicago at the age of 17. So think about this. This is a boy that hit on his own at like probably, 14, 15 years old?
I mean, in those days it was, 14 was old back then, believe it or not. And I love the stories, and I'm sure you've read a couple of them, is he used to hitch a ride under the rails.
Remind me of that De Niro movie, where the guy was trying to escape underneath the rails.
I mean, it's something out of a movie, but that actually, riding the rails. That's what he did. He hitched on top of, railroad cars.
Chicago, September 1900, battling Nelson lost his first decision to a guy named Joe Headmark, a six-round decision. Now, I have to ask, in the book, again, there's a lot of, obviously wins, losses, wins by knockout, et cetera, et cetera. So an awful lot, and I don't mean exhibitions, there's an awful lot of ND, no decision, or in this case, I thought six rounds. Later, they're fighting 40, 30, 20 rounds.
It depends where you were.
So it was all based on the state.
All based on where you were as to how many rounds were legal. And that's the key thing. And the ND for no decision was a legal thing. I think it was 1911 in New York.
Now, would that be considered a draw now, or that really is not in vogue now?
The reason it came about is because gambling was playing very heavy into boxing, and they wanted to try to curtail some of the gambling. So they passed a law saying that from now on, unless a guy gets a clean knockout, everything's a no decision.
Well, and you had the fighters, because he bet on himself actually to win, and sometimes he lost, and he would lose $1,000.
And you're going to see later on what happens, and even some of the ring record books have been rewritten, that they went with newspaper decisions. So you would get newspapers, they would say, okay, Larry, you and I will fight in the Hartford Courant, whoever they say won. That's what we're going to go by, because we know it's a 10-round no decision, no matter what happens.
Oh, okay.
So what happened was I put maybe, to make a little extra money on the side, Oscar, whoever he's fighting, would put like $5,000 down on himself, and they would take the word of whoever was sitting in the audience that they agreed would give him an honest assessment.
Wow.
And so that's why you see so many, the no decision error is what it's
this
called.
This is a shot of Battling Nelson's arrival in Goldfield, Nevada, August of 1906, I should say. And again, that was for the, was that for the first Gans fight.
Yeah.
To go back to that one in 1900 with Joe Hedmark, again, just to show you how crazy, you know, the whole thing of boxing was versus now, where now it's gone too much the other way, some would say. Nelson was dropped 17 times and Hedmark 5. Now, if you were dropped 3 times, they would probably call the fight.
Yeah,
you know,
free knockdown rule.
Oh, absolutely. Mark Allen Baker joining us here for the hour on Studio 411. The book, Battling Nelson, The Durable Dane, McFarlane Publishing, world lightweight champion. Born 1882, lived until 1954. Our friend Mark Allen Baker joining us, and again, just a terrific story. And again, it just goes to show that it's like there's always these, I call them nuggets, whether it's athletes, politicians, people going back probably before the beginning of even the written word, that if there's a way to really, you know, get at what happened and substantiate it, you know. And I think you did a marvelous job with this because, you know, we think 1900 seems like an eternity to a lot of people. But, you know, again, newspapers played, I'm sure, a key part in your research.
Oh, absolutely. Hundreds and hundreds. I've got binders and binders and binders, as you can imagine. I spent 6-7 months just doing primary research. And it was intensive going through everything. And I found things that I actually rewrote a lot of boxing history by finding fights that have never been recorded.
Yeah.
Finding fights that I can find no record of but are in the ring record book, so I can't substantiate.
This is Joe Gans, correct?
We'll
be talking about him through the hour. Just to give you a little bit of kind of perspective, in 1900, the U.S. population was 75 million. So, you know, again, obviously it sounds like a lot, but compared to over 300, I believe, now, some hundred and nearly 20 years later, it's, you know, quite a difference. Here's a... illustration, whatever we want to call it, Joe Gans on the right, battling Nelson, ready for the attack. And I assume this was probably before the first of their three bouts.
What a trilogy when you think of it. I mean, the first really good trilogy in boxing, it really solidified, and it really helped boxing on a lot. It's totally overlooked, in my opinion, where we've got a white fighter and a black fighter. Now, in all honesty, Joe Gans, after the low blow in the first fight, didn't have to give Battling Nelson a chance again. But yet, being a gentleman and being a champion gives Battling Nelson, a white fighter, a chance, and vice versa. So when Nelson wins, he gives Gans a chance to win as well.
I mean, I was impressed that, you know, as you said, and I thought the record for battling was 3, but you're saying with Mr. Wallstadt, correct?
Wallgast,
or was it Britt? And
Jimmy Britt, he fought four times.
Okay, yeah.
And that was a brilliant series because Britt may be a Hall of Famer in many ways. And the funny story is once Jimmy Britt said, you know, I'm done with boxing, his brother ended up moving over and actually managed Battling Nelson for the last two Gans fights.
Gotcha.
Willis Britt.
1903, turning point in his career. Obviously, then you know the purses got better, adulation, the success grew bigger and bigger, and that really was, I would say, from reading the book, that 1903 really was when he started his solid ascent.
All the way up to till he lost the title to Wilgas in 1910.
Now. Couple of things again that I had to remind myself of, and it's easy to forget in this fast-paced day and age that we live in. Two things come to mind. One was notice all these fights were always in the daytime because there was no lights, or at least not.
Yeah.
I mean, there wasn't lights in Major League Baseball till 1938. So certainly, 1900, 1910, not happening.
Yeah, and again, during the day they could film. So once the film stand started to get set up, as it got darker, it got harder, the film wasn't as advanced as it was. So they were almost trying to hurry the fight to get it in time so that they could film it. And there's a neat story, too, and this always caught me off guard. When he was fighting, I think it was Dick Hyland, and they were filming it, and they could only do it up to 20 rounds. That's all they had to film for. So Nelson started actually directing the fight to the, he was paying the camera people, and they only had so much film, and they kept on asking him, is this the round you're going to knock him out? He said, oh, yes, you know, so don't film the next round or film this round.
And wow.
So there was a lot of that going on, which I never knew before.
Talk about staged to a certain degree. Yeah,
that he actually staged it. There's the monument that's at Goldfield.
It's a Goldfield, Nevada, 42 rounds, September 3rd, 1906. The first Gans-Nelson fight that, of course, Gans won on a low blow.
I have to wonder how many people pass that and even know those two guys.
Yeah.
You know, when you go by, when we go by monuments here in Connecticut, so many great monuments and their names on them.
I've talked to you about it. Phil Gaduti, who is a historian in his own right. Again, you know, all you have to do is look at your own little local street or whatever, and it could be the simplest name in the book, and all of a sudden, well, it probably is tied to somebody or something. But, you know, don't ask me why, I always remember the one in Derby, David Humphreys Road. And, of course, you know,
great
again,
Humphreys.
People just think, well, come up with a long name like that. Well, go to your history books, and then, you know, then we all kind of learn, and we say, oh, now I understand why.
Yeah, go down to Grove Street Cemetery in New Haven, where he's buried.
You know, I came to realize that something, unless it was 1st, 2nd, 3rd, 4th Street, probably, if it was just first and nothing else, it probably might be named after somebody. Yeah. You never know. You know what I'm saying? Radio also didn't play a part because, Marconi and the boys, you know, were still working the bugs out.
That was coming down the pike. And I thought about that. I even talked about it a little bit in the book. Is just how much more these guys would have had their career. I mean, how much more would it do for their career to have the media coverage? I mean, he just came around with a film. They started making money on film. They started making money on vaudeville appearances, you know, with showing a little clips, doing some sparring.
Radio would have been outstanding.
Would have been killer for him.
The problem is by the time radio got really entrenched, then he perhaps might have become passé or whatever, because, you know, people's shelf life, you know, tends to dim after a while. There was a quote here that I wanted to bring up. I noticed it appears Battling never fought in Hartford, Connecticut, although there was one fight, and I'm just having a problem. I think it was the then reigning champion Terry McGovern fought someone called Young Corbett II.
That was a great fight.
In what they call the Coliseum in Hartford, Connecticut.
Yeah,
I assume that was
a
very old Coliseum.
Yeah, that was a great fight. It was probably the best fight ever held in Hartford.
There's another shot from that epic fight in Goldfield, Nevada. There's Mr. Gans on the right and Battling Nelson on the left.
And a lot of people at this time were saying, you know, Gans, like we mentioned, died of tuberculosis. And a lot of people thought he was suffering at that time. And we really didn't become noticeable. As I started reading and doing my research, really wasn't noticeable until the second fight.
Sure.
Maybe the third fight for sure was noticeable. He was having trouble.
Talk about, any potential scandal, underhanded activities. I think you kind of alluded to a couple already, even with anytime gambling gets involved, that might have gone on in boxing in those early 20th century years.
This is interesting for me because, I mean, Nelson was about as clean cut as they come back then. I mean, he wore his emotions on his sleeve, never smoked, never drank. He refused to throw fights, and people always, I mean, whether we know, like it or not, people threw fights to make a few extra bucks. They gambled on the side. That was part of boxing, was the gambling. It's a way to make extra money. It was considered that, you know, that's fine. You know, hey, you know, I understand totally. You got to make ends meet. But as far as Nelson was concerned, that's what intrigued me about him. He didn't fall for the gambling. He wasn't throwing fights while other people were throwing fights. And for me, the interesting aspect was going from one biography of a guy who never threw a fight to a guy like Abraham Hotel, who's my next biography, who was involved in everything.
Right.
Attell did everything. He would call rounds and make sure that he was holding the guy up to make the eighth round. I mean, if that's what it took, you know, he was willing to do it.
I'll talk about it. In one of these fights, there was a dispute about who was refereeing the fight, and that
happened quite a bit.
Almost held up the fight. That plays
into the boxing.
Yeah.
The gambling. The boxing as a gambling option. they would constantly go back and forth. Well, I want him, or I want, you know, John L. Sullivan, or no, I want Eddie Graney, or I want whatever. They would go back and forth because all fighters like you know how pitchers in baseball have certain umpires that they always to get a better, bigger strike zone. Same with referees. There was guys that really wouldn't call some of the headbutts on Nelson that he was notorious for, so that he would always push for those, for the referees that, you know, would work to his style. And that's only logical, and it made a lot of sense. Yeah. So I can understand it being one of those, you know, negotiable points.
Now, and I guess this would have been probably the earliest, in December 1905, Nelson got engaged to a showgirl. Again, the first of several, we'll call them aborted romances.
Aborted romances, good way to put it. I mean, this was the most interesting thing that he never covered in his autobiography. So as I'm learning more and more, his fiancés are surfacing as fast as his sparring partners. And I just couldn't get over it because he was constantly being taken to court because he was engaged to three or four women at the time or whatever the scenario happened to be. He did end up, he had a three-day marriage in his first marriage, which was kind of, which I cover in detail in the book. But women weren't his forte.
Yeah.
He had trouble with them.
There's a quote in the book that I liked from Oscar battling Nelson. Quote, "I am not Irish. I certainly love the green."
So. He wore green trunks. Green trunks brought him good luck.
I thought it was because he liked
he liked money.
That's
what it applied to.
Because I got the impression from his upbringing or struggles once his parents came to this country that, you know, he seemed like he knew, you know, where every penny was, which we'll talk a little bit about later.
Did. Yeah, yeah. And he did. Yeah. He didn't know where
every penny was. Here's from a newspaper of the day. "Gann wins on foul, and then he broke his right hand in the 33rd round of the fight." Again, another time that I'm trying to think of a fight that I remember in the 70s where someone broke their hand and continued to fight. Wasn't it what Ali against
Norton, right?
The first Norton fight, yeah.
Norton broke his ribs or...
Yeah,
I thought Norton broke Ollie's ribs.
Right, but I think there was a hand to
an
issue. And again, of course, they obviously were able to keep it hidden, but obviously
he didn't want to lead
diminished the potential to win the fight. So, but again, because of the low blow, obviously didn't have to. But that was in round 33. Again, I can't even.
I know. It tells the same way.
Now boxing is what? They don't even 15. Do they do 15? I thought it was 12.
12.
In some states. You know.
Yeah, I mean, it went from 15 to 12 to, you know, whatever is appropriate at the time.
Now, you ranked Nelson versus Gans, the trilogy, as one of the best in boxing history. Well, I'm thinking of Ali Frazier. I'm thinking of Ali. Again, this is more in a heavier class, which is more
I think
my
it's
forte.
Symbolism.
Ali, Ken Norton, I believe, fought three times. I'm sure probably the...
Well, there's a lot of... There's a little,
Sugar Ray Robinson probably fought a couple of guys two or
Ramada
three times.
Five times.
Yeah, yeah.
So, I mean, but I like the symbolism of it. I like the symbolism of it, the fact that it's a white fighter versus a black. You broke down the barriers. You know, boxing, it grew a lot because these two fighters fought each other. And it really, that symbolism is what's important here.
Now, overall, we alluded to it before. Was Nelson, when all was said and done, was he a good businessman? Because I was kind of shocked how things kind of ended at the
end.
They
evaporated quickly.
Was that because of the Depression?
He started buying a lot of property.
But see, I would have thought that would have been good. They always said in the old days, buy real estate, buy real estate.
What happened is he's buying so much real estate that the people, he had a little run-ins with his Chicago politicians too. In fact, he threatened to run for a lot of districts every time an assemblyman gave him a hard time. What happened was he bought so much property that they were actually taxing him for development of the property that he was buying. So he had to install sewer systems, all sorts of things, all sorts of utilities and all the developments that he bought.
Okay.
So they started hitting him up for added
cost. So unless you developed on all of them, then you were basically...
So he's you know, and then he started, when he ran into problems, suing everybody. So next thing you know, now he's got a ton of legal fees. And of course, you know, he had a lot of women who were suing him too as well. And it just, I mean, he was constant. Every time I was reading an article, Battling Nelson's going to sue him. Constantly, he eventually sued for the name Battling.
Wow.
I mean, that's how far it got, where he sued Battling Levinsky for using Battling.
There's a still from one of those fights you talked about. Again,
pictures,
Again, that's green shoes. So again,
there's a story. He actually
could have gotten an endorsement deal
green
now.
Green shoes, green trunks. He was wearing green for a while. That's his.
That's the you alluded to it earlier. Again,
right there.
Paperback 50 cents, cloth $1.22. Or I'm reading that correctly? Yeah, $1.25 perhaps. Written by himself. That's quite
not
a way.
Not quite. In fact,
little ghost written there. Perhaps.
Yeah. In fact, some of the ghostwriters actually use an attorney themselves to come after Mr. Nelson, saying it's not quite correct.
I always knew boxing was a very litigious, sport, but I didn't realize until I read this book that lawyers were everywhere.
They're everywhere. I mean, it's an interesting book. It's a really good book because it really shows so many elements of our society. It shows the racism.
And even
racism.
A better book and much better researched, our guest, Mark Allen Baker, author of Battling Nelson, the Durable Dane. He was white world lightweight champion as well, according to what you were saying. But world lightweight champion who lived between 1882 and 1954. Mark joining us for the hour here on Studio 411. For more information, www.mcfarlandpub.com. You were going to say something.
The interesting thing, too, and even my wife pointed out to me, she said, there's so much to it. There's a story of the fighter, but there's a story of the man. There's a story of romance. He falls in love with a countess who's a multimillionaireess, and it goes on and on and on. So I've got relationships, marriages, divorces, suicides. I mean, it's just so many elements that play into the book that make it a fascinating read.
I found this. This is in some library in South Dakota to a Rudolph Forster, I believe. Compliments of Battling Nelson, July 15th, 1910. So certainly...
Assistant Secretary to President Taft.
There you go. All right.
But look at from Hegwisch.
He was good chums with Teddy Roosevelt, too.
Big time. Went to the White House. Teddy invited him. Of course, Teddy knew a photo op when he saw it, too.
Oh, and I just remembered, I have to tell the audience this, that I did not know, and correct me if I'm wrong. Now, I knew Teddy Roosevelt ascended to president when McKinley was shot, correct?
Mm-hmm. That's correct.
But I did not know, and I mean, this is like, talk about a history from all angles, that Roosevelt, who was Secretary of the Navy, as I believe later was FDR, but I could be wrong on that. That he actually took the VP slot when the gentleman whose name escapes me passed away.
Yeah.
So I think that's a remarkable story that ascended from, let's say, Secretary of Navy or whatever position he had to VP and then ultimately to president. I mean, talk about hop, skip, and jump.
Roosevelt was an amazing man, Teddy Roosevelt. Just an absolutely amazing man. Loved boxing. And of course was involved in New York City for a long time.
This one here, if you want a real champion, write to or see Jack Dempsey, and he gives him the town in New York where he is.
That?
Tell Jack something, and he'll give you his autograph. Tell Jack I said to autograph a picture for you. I'm sure he will. All the best, your friend Battling Nelson. So again, a very affable gentleman. How was he with people in general?
Well, Dempsey became a good friend. Dempsey kind of, Bat turned into a character. He was a real character.
And now this is one I found from 1944, so this is in the last decade of his life.
Yeah.
To Donna, may you live long and die happy. Battling Nelson. Okay. Lightweight champion 1908 to 1910. So, very, very approachable, obviously.
Oh, yeah. And he, like you said, he became a character. He started suffering when Dempsey, who ruled the 20s, became so popular. Bat actually covered a couple of his fights. And
of course, Dempsey went on to that long career as a restaurateur.
Yeah, and who didn't stop by
sure.
to see Jack Dempsey? And Jack Dempsey knew everybody in New York City.
Yeah, I'm trying to remember when that closed, but I don't know if I might have walked
there
by there back in the day.
Them. Yeah. He moved it.
Yeah, but there
they said,
if you had an opportunity to go there, that was really
oh,
something.
Oh, yeah, he used to autograph the postcards, the Furpo postcards. Remember that? The picture of who is it, the Bellows that did that painting? That famous painting of Furpo going through between the ropes? Or I can't think of it.
I forget.
But anyway, you said,
there was that famous one where in later years, you know, Jack is being held, you know, by somebody. And I don't think battling is in the
picture. Oh, that was the Houdini shot.
Yeah, Houdini shot. Yeah, with Harry
Houdini. With Benny Leonard. Benny Leonard's holding him back. And Benny Leonard, the best Jewish boxer ever.
In the remaining moments, and I have to bring him up, just give me like a 3/4 of a minute on the great, what was it, the based on the movie, The Great White Hope, Mr., was it Sullivan?
John L.
Obviously, you know, he was married to a Caucasian woman, so I'm sure
You mean Jack Johnson?
Jack Johnson. Your pardon, yeah. So I'm sure that that didn't endear him to society in those days. And
no, he did time,
Oh, for the Mann Act. Yeah, that reminded me of like Chuck Berry for that same ridiculous law.
I can't believe, you know, you look back at this as a historian and you look at just how it's just archaic the way we thought back then. It's just so backward. And I mean, and
from what I'm seeing, we're still thinking archaic at times, but that's for another book in a few years. But I love this. You know, nothing like taking a stroll in the snow with an open-topped, I don't even know what kind of vehicle
that is. There's a spokesperson for that car, and then the name of the car.
Oh, was that a Model T or no?
No, it was another type of car. He actually went across country with a wrestling friend of his.
Now, this is battling on the right, correct?
Yeah, that's him on the right. I'm trying to think out who that is.
Yeah, that was in, I'm going to say, later years. But yeah, so the shoes, obviously, a little more in keeping. The boxers look like something I wear today, so not when I'm boxing either. So
he was rather tall. He was a rather tall man.
But actually, all of them tended to be a little on the smaller side, which again, in this case, that weight class for 130, 135, 140 really fit their size. You know, they were not. There was one in your book you had where the gentleman looked like he was about 7 feet tall, and there was a comment that you said that they thought he could have beat some famous boxer or whatever. I forget. I don't have it here at handy, but most of them they tended to be under 6 feet tall. But so did most people in those days.
Yeah, absolutely right. Very seldom.
Now this I would say a younger battling.
Very
Nelson,
young in that case.
You know, so the years of boxing. Now, what would you say did he lived a good long life when you think about some of his contemporaries, but do you think that ultimately the toll of all those hits really did a lot of
damage? Started showing signs during the 20s. I mean, the head injuries, which I'm so against. I'm so against. I talk to people all the time. You know, I'm an advocate of headgear. It's just traumatic. Of course,
and you see that in football. You see where people in how many players, and I'm sure in other sports, hockey as well, they say, well, they had failed businesses. Well, why? Because they probably weren't making rational decisions, which could have, in addition to the depression and the legal issues, property-wise and other, probably those factors combined to him. Because I couldn't believe he lost basically most of his fortune.
Yeah, not only that, and most of his memory. Wow. By the end, when he had dementia so bad and couldn't even remember his wife's name.
Now, he did get married, I saw, near the end of the book.
In the end, he married someone that he knew from his show days.
And,
but he couldn't even remember her maiden name, and he buried her. I don't know how he did it. Couldn't find a record as to just how he managed to pull it off, but she died just prior to him. And he was institutionalized, finally, because they could no longer care for him.
Wow.
And it was tragic. The ending was just horrible for him. And in the end, the woman he was married to for 3 days, the famous cartoonist, Faye Barber King.
Oh, back in the teens, 19.
She ended up paying for his funeral along with the boxing.
Yeah, they seemed like there was some amicable,
A lot of the fighters who respected him turned out. I got pictures of the funeral with Tony Zale. I was telling Tony Zale's nephew. Got a picture of Tony was holding one side of the casket. But and Johnny Coulon, there was a bunch of them that a lot of boxing turned out in the end for the funeral for him, which was nice because he didn't know where he didn't know where his meals were coming from at the end. He was so poor.
But again, I still found it amazing that unlike so many of his contemporaries, you know, he lived a long life. I'm not saying the end was good, but I mean, at this point, to the age of 72.
That was what I wanted to try to do is what happened? What happened after 1908? You know, when we left you, Bat, you were visiting the White House in 1909. to visit Teddy Roosevelt, and that's the last we heard of him. And that's really the reason why I wanted to write the book, is
now,
to put the pieces together.
1917, he fought his last fight. I know he fought a couple of exhibitions later on, but by that point, I mean, I know he tried to stage kind of a in-house comeback or whatever.
No one had ever done a comeback before. See, comebacks, that was unheard of. Nobody in his weight class had ever successfully had a comeback.
Right.
So he was the first one to attempt a comeback, to try to work his way back into the mix, which he didn't do. He did end up in a swan song fighting Freddie Welch at the end.
Right, it was a boxing was champion
but,
from...
But, I mean, Welch could have killed him
from Britain, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, Welch was a great defensive
man. I got the impression like he almost took it easy on him at the end.
I think so.
He thought he was gonna do more damage than people would imagine.
So. Which was a nice way. It was a nice swan song for him. He tried very hard. I mean, he even traveled to Mexico to try to get fights. I mean, he tried leaving the country. To try to, you know, for whatever opportunities he could get, but it got tough. I mean, it got real hard.
There's a quote from Battling Nelson, quote, "When I do retire, people will say of me, quote, he was the most honest fighter that ever graced the ring, and if there were more like him, it would be a boost to the game." Battling Nelson, so.
A man of integrity. I mean, to think that he would never throw a fight when he had every opportunity to make big money.
Now, here's a shot in our remaining moments here. And that was March of 38. So Battling is on the left there. And again, you know, still looking very dapper.
Battling his famous left scissors.
I was going to say,
it's a punch to the liver.
That was his specialty, right? Yeah.
Yeah, where we'd come in almost in the old days, almost like this, but literally come in. I mean, most people thought he tucked the thumb further in and come in on the liver like this from the side to do more damage.
And that would kind of stun them for a little bit.
Kid Gavilan hit the bolo punch.
Yeah.
Well, that was his trademark, which was kind of something Choynski worked with him on. And I mean, it was more of a you know, novelty than an actual.
And in those days, I mean, as you see even in old films, like I remember Abbott and Costello and somebody, when they would put boxing in Three Stooges, you know, that thumb really, you know, had a showcase, you know, it stood out much more. This was back in about 3-4 years before he passed. I guess a couple of muggers tried to steal his money
on the street.
And 68-year-old Nelson, again, he lived to be 72, drove off his attacker. So never let it be said that he might not have been sharp of mind, but he certainly still knew how to defend himself.
And that's amazing.
I found that shot, and I was like, I said, oh, this is amazing.
You know? I've got quite a few shots of him from that encounter. No, he wasn't bashful. I mean, he didn't duck. He didn't duck any. But he heard screams from a house, so he wanted to get involved. And so anyway, he got involved in a lot of scenarios that he probably crossed the line on. But that's the way he was.
Amazing.
That's the way he was.
All right, Mark, always a pleasure to have you here.
Nice to be here, Larry.
And the book, Battling Nelson, The Durable Dane, Mark Allen Baker, the author. I keep saying white because I keep remembering that Joe Gans title, the fight. He was the
one. Gans was the black champion.
Yeah, the black and the white. I can't believe
that. That's how archaic we were.
And you know, now we have like the same division with three boxing
Now we
champs.
Have more champions than
yeah,
we need.
Yeah, exactly, that we need.
Go back to 7 weight class.
World lightweight champion who lived from 1882 to 1954. Again, McFarlane Publishers, www.mcfarlanepub.com. for more information. And again, just for the record, passed away, cause given was from lung cancer, but obviously dementia and other things played a part in February of 1954. So there we go. Great book. Look forward to hopefully a movie. Good things come out of it.
Yeah, a lot of people are interested in it, and it's really, it's got a lot of attention, and it would be nice. It's a good story.
Look forward to hearing more about it, and we look forward to having you back on
thank
the show
very
soon.
Thank you.
Terrific. We thank you for joining us here for this episode of Studio 411. I'm Larry Dasilva. He's Mark Allen Baker, and we thank you so much for joining us. Have a great day.